أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم Hello dear ladies and gentlemen Today I will discuss with you about healing So first of all I am coming to discuss with you the definition of the healing The word healing used in a pathological context refers to the body replacement of destroyed tissue by living tissue So process of healing occur in the following way The healing process involves two distinct processes, regeneration, the replacement of lost tissue by tissue similar in type, and repair, healing by scarring, the replacement of lost tissue by granulation tissue with which mature to form scar tissue. Healing by fibrosis is innervated with the surrounding specialized cell do not possess the capacity to proliferate. Whether healing takes place by regeneration or by repair is determined partly by type of cell in the damaged organ or partly by the destruction or the intactness of the stromal framework of the organ. Hence, it is important to know the types of cell in the body. So now we are coming to discuss with you the type of cell in the body. Based on their proliferative capacity, there are three types of cell. First is labile cell. These are cells which have a continuous turn or by programmed division of stem cell. They are found in the surface epithelium of the gastrointestinal tract, urinary tract or the skin. The cell of lymphoid and hemophytic system are further example of labile cell. The chances of regeneration are excellent. On second stage comes stable cells. Tissue which have such type of cell have normally a much lower level of replication and there are few stem cells. However, the cell of such tissues can undergo rapid division in response to injury. For example, mesenchymal cell, such as smooth muscle cell, fibroblast, osteoblast and endothelial cell are stable cells. Which can proliferate liver endocrine gland and renal tubular epithelium has also such type of cell which can regenerate. Their chances of regeneration are good. So now we are coming to discuss with you permanent cell. So these are non-dividing cell. If lost, permanent cell cannot be replaced because they do not have the capacity of proliferate. Example of permanent cell are adult neuron, striated muscle cell and cell of the lens. Having been introduced to the types of cell, we can go back to the types of the healing process and elaborate them. So we are coming to discuss with you healing process by regeneration. Definition of regeneration are regeneration actually generate mean bring to life is the renewal of lost tissue in which The lost cells are replaced by identical ones. So we will discuss regeneration involve two processes. On first stage come proliferation of surviving cell to replace lost of tissue. On second step come migration of the surviving cell into the vacant space. The capacity of a tissue for regeneration depends on its proliferative ability, degree of damage to stromal framework, and on the type of and severity of the damage. Tissue form of labile and stable cell can regenerate provided their stromal framework are intact. So now we are coming to discuss with you repair healing by connective tissue. Definition of repair are repair is the orderly process by which lost tissue is eventually replaced by a scar. A wound in which only the lining epithelium is affected heal exclusively by regeneration. In the contrast, wound that extend through the basement membrane to the connective tissue. Example of the repair are the dermis in the skin or the submucosa in the gastrointestinal tract lead to the formation of granulation tissue and eventually scarring. Tissue containing terminally differentiated permanent cells such as neuron and skeletal muscle cell cannot heal by regeneration. Rather, the lost permanent cells are replaced by formation of granulation tissue In the granulation tissue formation, three phases may be observed. On first step come phase of inflammation. At this phase, inflammatory exudate containing polymers is seen in the area of a tissue injury. In addition, there is platelet aggregation and fibrin deposition. On second step come phase of demolition. The dead cell liberate their autolytic enzyme and other enzyme proteolytic come from disintegrating polymorphs. There is an associated macrophage in infiltration. This cell ingest particulate matter, either digesting or removing it. In growth of granulation tissue, this is characterized by proliferation of fibroblasts and in growth of a new blood vessel into the area of injury with a variable number of inflammatory cells. Fibroblasts actively synthesize and secrete extracellular matrix component, including fibronectin, proteoglycans, and collagen types 1 and type 3. The fibronectin and proteoglycan form the scaffolding for rebuilding of the matrix. Fibronectin bind to fibrin and act as a chemotactic factor for the recruitment of more fibroblasts and macrophages. The synthesis of collagen by fibroblasts begin within 24 hours of the injury, although its deposition in the tissue is not apparent until 4 days. By day 5, collagen type 3 is the predominant matrix protein being produced, but by day 7 to 8, type 1 is prominent and is eventually become the major collagen of mature scar tissue. This type 1 collagen is responsible for providing the tensile strength of the matrix in a scar, coincident with fibroblasts proliferation. There is angiogenesis, new vascularization, a proliferation and formation of new small blood vessels. Vascular proliferation start 48 to 72 hours after injury and lasts for several days. With further healing, there is an increase in extracellular constituent, mostly collagen, with a decrease in the number of active fibroblasts and new vessels, despite an increased collagen activity in the wound, which are responsible for the removal of built collagen. Collagen accumulates at a steady rate, usually reaching a maximum 2 to 3 months after the injury. The tensile strength of the wounds continues to increase many months after the collagen content has reached a maximum. As the collagen content of the wound increases, many of the newly formed vessels disappear. This vascular inulation, which takes place in a few weeks, dramatically transforms a richly vascularized tissue into a pale, a vascular scar tissue. Now we are coming to discuss with you wound contraction. So wound contraction is a mechanical reduction in the size of a defect. The wound is reduced approximately by 70 to 80% of its original size. Contraction result in much faster healing, since only one third of the amount of destroyed tissue has to be replaced. If contraction is prevented, healing is slow and a largely ugly scar is formed. Causes of contraction are: it is said to be due to contraction by myofibroblasts. Myofibroblasts have the feature intermediate between those of fibroblasts and smooth muscle cell. 2 to 3 days after the injury, they migrate into the wound and their active contraction decreases the size of the defect. So we are coming to discuss with you molecular control of healing process. As seen above, healing involves an orderly sequence of events, which includes regeneration and migration of specialized cell, angiogenesis, proliferation of fibroblasts and related cell matrix protein synthesis, and finally cessation of these processes. These processes, at least in part, are mediated by a series of low molecular weight Fully peptide refer to a growth factor. These growth factors have the capacity to stimulate cell division and proliferation. Some of the factors known to play a role in the healing process are briefly discussed below. Sources of growth factor are: following injury, growth factor may be derived from a number of sources such as platelets activated, after endothelial damage, damaged epithelial cell, circulating serum growth factor, macrophages or lymphocyte required to the area of the injury. The healing process ceases when lost tissue has been replaced. The mechanism regulating this process are not fully understood. TGF beta acts as a growth inhibitor for both epithelial and endothelial cell and regulate their regeneration. So now I am coming to discuss with you wound healing. The two processes of healing described above can occur during healing of diseased organ or during healing of a wound. What is wound? A wound can be accidental or surgical. Now we will discuss 10 wound healing to demonstrate the two basic processes of healing mentioned above. Healing of a wound demonstrates both epithelial regeneration, healing of the epidermis, and repair by scarring healing of the dermis. There are two patterns of wound healing. Depending on the amount of tissue damage, healing by first intention, primary union, healing by second intention, secondary union. These two patterns are essentially the same process, varying only in the amount. Now I am coming to discuss with you healing by first intention or primary union. The least complicated example of the wound healing is the healing of a clean surgical incision. The wound is approximated by surgical suture and healing occurs with minimal loss of tissue. Such healing is referred to surgically as primary union or healing by first intention. The incision caused the death of a limited number of epithelial cells as well as epidermal and adnexa and connective tissue cell. The incisional space is narrow and immediately filled with clotted blood containing fibrin and blood cell. Dehydration of the surface clots form the well-known scab that covers the wound and seal it from the environment almost at once within 24 hours. Neutrophils appear at the margin of the incision, moving toward the fibrin clot. The epidermis at its cut edge thickens as a result of mitotic activity of the basal cell. And within 24 to 48 hours, super up the epithelial cell from the edge both migrate and grow along the cut margin of the dermis and beneath the surface caves to fuse in the midline, thus producing a continuous but thin epithelial layer. By the day 3, the neutrophils have been largely replaced by macrophages. Granulation tissue progressively invades the incisional space. Collagen fibers are now present in the margin of the incisional, but these are vertically oriented and do not bridge the incisional. Epithelial cell proliferation continues, thickening the epidermal covering layer. By day 5, the incisional space is filled with granulation tissue. Neovascularization is maximal. Collagen fibrils become more abundant and begin to bridge the incision. The epidermis recovers its normal thickness and differentiation of surface cell yield a mature epidermal architecture with surface keratinization. During the second week, there is continued accumulation of collagen and proliferation of fibroblasts, leukocyte infiltrate, edema, and increased vascularity have largely disappeared. At this time, the long process of blanching begins, accomplished by the increased accumulation of collagen within the incisional scar, accompanied by regression of vascular channel. By the end of the first month, the scar comprises a cellular connective tissue devoid of the inflammatory infiltrate covered now by an intact epidermis. The dermal appendages, they have been destroyed in the line of the incision, are permanently lost. Tensile strain of the wound increased thereafter, but it makes months for the wound area to obtain its maximal strength. Now I am coming to discuss with you healing by second intention or secondary union. When there is more extensive loss of cell and tissue occur, such as occur in an infection, inflammatory ulceration, abscesses formation and surface wound that create largely defect, the reparative process is more complicated. The common denominator in these in all these situations is a largely tissue defect that must be filled. Regeneration of parenchymal cell cannot completely reconstitute the original architecture. Abandoned granulation tissue grows in form the margin to complete the repair. The form, this form of healing is referred to as secondary union or healing by second intention. Secondary healing differ from primary healing in several respects, which are inevitably large tissue defect initially have more fibrin and more necrotic debris and exudate that must be removed. Consequently, the inflammatory reaction is more intense. And second step are much larger amount of granulation tissue or perm with a largely defect occur in deeper tissue, such as in a viscous granulation tissue, bear the full responsibility for its closure because drainage to the surface cannot occur. And third step come, perhaps the feature that most clearly differentiate primary from secondary healing is the phenomena of wound contraction, which occur in largely surface wound. Healing by second intention takes much longer than when it's occur by first intention. Now I am coming to discuss with you factors that influence wound healing. A number of factors can alter the rate and efficiency of healing. These can be classified into those which act locally and those which have systematic effects. Most of these factors have been established in studies of skin wound healing, but many are likely to be of relevance to healing or other sites. Now I am coming to discuss with you local factor of wound healing. So their type, size and location of the wound are: a clean aseptic wound reproduced by the surgeon, scalpel heal faster than a wound produced by a blunt trauma, which exhibit abundant necrosis. As in my previous lecture I discussed with you, necrosis is a cell death, a naturally occurring of a cell death, and irregular is small blunt wound heal faster than large wound. Injuries is richly vascularized area, e.g. the face, heal faster than those in poorly vascularized one, e.g. the foot. In area where the skin adhere to bony surface, as in injuries over the tibia, wound contraction and adequate apposition of the edge are difficult. Hence, such wound heals slowly. Now, I am coming to discuss with you vascular supply to the wound healing. Wound with impaired blood supply heals slowly. For example, the healing of leg wound in patient with varicose vein is prolonged ischemia due to the pressure produced blood source and then prevent their healing. Ischemia due to arterial obstruction happen in the lower extremities of diabetes also prevent healing. Now I am coming to discuss with you infection. So what is infection? Infection is wound provide a portal of entry for microorganism. Infection delay or prevent healing, promote the formation of excessive granulation tissue, proud flesh, and may result in large deforming scar. Now I am coming to discuss with you a moment. So what is moment? movement is the early motion, particularly before tensile strain has been established, subject wound to persistent trauma, thus preventing or retarding healing. Now I am coming to discuss with you ionizing radiation. So what is ionizing radiation? Ionizing radiation are prior irradiation loose vascular lesion that interfere with blood supply and result in slow wound healing. Acutely irradiation of a wound blocks cell proliferation, inhibit contraction and retard the formation of granulation tissue. Now I am coming to discuss with you systematic picture of the wound healing. So on first step comes circulatory status, cardiovascular status by determining the blood supply to the injured area is important for wound healing. Poor healing attribute the old age is often due to largely to impaired circulation. Now I am coming to discuss with you infection of the wound healing, of the systematic picture of the wound healing. So systematic infection delay wound healing. So in this metabolic status are poorly controlled diabetes mellitus is associated with delayed wound healing. The risk of infection is in clean wound approach biofood, the risk in non-diabetics. In diabetic patient there can be impaired circulation secondary to arteriosclerosis and impaired sensation due to diabetic neuropathy. The impaired sensation rendered to the lower extremity blind in to everyday hazard. Hence in diabetic patient wound heal in the is very slowly. Now I am coming to discuss with you nutritional deficiencies. So on first team other protein deficiency. In protein depletion there is an impairment of granulation tissue and collagen formation resulting in a great delay in wound healing. So on second step come vitamin deficiency. Vitamin C is required for collagen synthesis and secretion. It is required in hydroxylation of prolein and lysine in the process of collagen synthesis. Vitamin C deficiency results in grossly deficient wound healing with the lack of vascular proliferation and collagen deposition. Now I am coming to discuss with you trace element deficiency. Zinc, a co-factor of several enzyme deficiency will retard healing by preventing cell proliferation. Zinc is necessary in several DNA and RNA polymerases and transferases. Hence, a deficiency state will inhibit mitosis proliferation of fibroblasts. Fibroblastia is therefore retarded. Now, I am coming to discuss with you hormones. So, what is hormone? So, in corticosteroid impair wound healing, an effect attribute to inhibition of collagen synthesis. However, these hormones have many other effects, including anti-inflammatory action and a general depletion of protein synthesis. It also inhibits fibroplasia and new vascularization. Both epithelialization and contraction are impaired. It is therefore difficult to attribute their inhibition of wound healing to any one specific mechanism. So thyroid hormone, androgen, estrogen and growth hormone are also influence wound healing. This effect, however, may be more due to their regulation of general metabolic status rather than to a specific modification of the wound healing process. So now I am coming to discuss with you anti-inflammatory drugs. So anti-inflammatory medication do not interfere with wound healing when administered with the usual daily dosage, aspirin and endomethaline. Both inhibit prostaglandin synthesis and thus delay healing. Complications of wound healing are abnormalities in any of three basic healing processes. Contraction, reappear, repair and regeneration result in the complication of wound healing. So now I am coming to discuss with you infection. So infection is a wound healing may provide the portal of entry for many organisms. Infection may delay healing, and if fever stop it completely. So now I am coming to discuss with you deficient scar formation, inadequate formation of granulation tissue, or inability to form a suitable extracellular matrix leads to deficient scar formation and its complication. The complication of deficient scar formation are wound dehiscence and incisional hernia, ulceration. Now I am coming to discuss with you wound dehiscence and incisional hernias. Dehiscence, bursting of a wound, is of most concern after abdominal surgery. If insufficient extracellular matrix is deposited, or there is inadequate cross-linking of the matrix, weak scar result. Dehiscence occur in 0.5% to 5% of abdominal operation. Inappropriate suture, maternal or enforced surgical technique are important factor. Wound infection increase mechanical stress on the wound form from vomiting, coughing or illness is a factor. In most cases of abdominal dehiscence, systemic factors that predispose to dehiscence include poor metabolic status such as vitamin C deficiency, hypoproteinemia, and the general inanition that often accompanies metastatic cancer. Dehiscence of the abdominal wall can be life-threatening complication in some studies, carrying a mortality as high as 30%. An incisional hernia, usually of the abdominal wall, refer to a defect caused by poor wound healing following surgery, into which the intestinal protrude. Now I am coming to discuss with you ulceration. Wound ulcerate because of an inadequate intrinsic blood supply or insufficient vascularization during healing. Example of ulceration are leg wound in person with varicose vein or severe atherosclerosis, typically ulcerate. Non-healing wound also develop in area devoid of sensation because of persistent trauma. Such traumatic or neuropathic ulcer are occasionally seen in patients with leprosy, diabetic peripheral neuropathy, and in tertiary sepals from spinal involvement in tapes dorsalis. Now I am coming to discuss with you excessive scar formation. So excessive deposition of extracellular matrix at the wound site result in hypertrophic scar or keloid, the rate of collagen synthesis, the ratio of type 3 to type 1 collagen, and the number of reducible or cross-linking remain high. A situation that indicates a maturation arrest or block in the healing process. Now I am coming to discuss with you keloid formation. So keloid is an excessive formation of collagen tissue result in the appearance of raised area of a scar tissue called keloid. It is an exuberant scar that tend to progress and recur after excision. The cause of this is unknown. Genetic predisposition, repeated trauma and irritation caused by foreign body hair, keratin, etc. may play a part. It is especially frequent after burn. It is common in area of the neck and in the ear lobes. Hypertrophic scar. So hypertrophic scar is structurally similar to keloid. However, hypertrophic scar never gets to worse after 6 months, unlike keloid, which gets worse even after a year, or some may even progress from 5 to 10 years. Following excision, keloids recur, whereas a hypertrophic scar does not. Now I am coming to discuss with you excessive contraction. A decrease in the synthesis in the size of a wound depends on the presence of myofibroblasts. Development of cell contracts and sustained cell contraction and exaggeration of these processes is termed contractor cicatrication and result in severe deformity of a wound and surrounding tissue. Contractor cicatrization is also said to arise as a result of the late reduction in the size of the wound. Interestingly, the region that normally show minimal wound contraction, such as the form, the sole, and the interior aspect of the thorax, are the one prone to contractures. Contractures are particularly conspicuous in the healing of the serious wound, contracture of the skin, and underlying connective tissue can be severe enough to compromise the movement of joints. Cicatrization is also important in hollow viscera such as urethra, esophagus, and intestine. It leads to progressive stenosis and stricture formation. In the elementary tract, a contracture stricture can result in the obstruction to the passage of the food. In the esophagus, are a block in the flow of the intestinal contract. Several diseases are characterized by contracture and irreversible fibrosis of the superficial fascia, including Dupuytren's disease, palmar contracture, plantar contracture, and Lederhosen disease, and Peyronie disease, contracture of the cavernous tissue of the penis. In these diseases, there is no known precipitating injury, even though the basic process is similar to contracture in wound healing. Miscellaneous implantation or epidermoid cysts, epithelial cells which flow into the healing wound, may later sometime persist and proliferate to form an epidermoid cyst. Fracture healing. The basic process involved in the healing of bone fracture bear many resemblance to those seen in the skin wound healing. Unlike healing, a fracture is repaired not by fibrous scar tissue and but by specialized bone forming tissue, so that under favorable circumstance the bone is restored nearly to normal. Now I am coming to discuss with you structure of bone. Bone is composed of classified osteoid tissue, which consists of collagen fiber embedded in the mucoprotein matrix, osteomucin. Depending on the arrangement of the collagen fiber, there are two histological types of bone. On first have come woven immature or non-lamellar bone. This show irregularity in the arrangement of the collagen bundle and in the distribution of the osteocyte. The osteomucin is least abundant and is also contains less calcium. Now I am coming to discuss with you lamellar or adult bone. So in this type of bone, the collagen bundle are arranged in parallel sheets. Stage in fracture healing, bone regeneration. Stage first is hematoma formation. Immediately following the injury, there is a variable amount of bleeding. From torn vessel, if the periosteum is torn, this blood may extend into the surrounding muscle. If it is subsequently organized and ossified, myostasis ossification result. In stage 2, inflammation occurs. The tissue damage excites an inflammatory response that exudates, adding more fibrin to the clots already present. The inflammatory charges differ in no way from those seen in other inflamed tissue. There is an increased blood flow and a polymorphonuclear leukocytic infiltration. The hematoma attained to fusiform shape, and third stage is demolition. Macrophages invade the clot and remove the fibrin red cell, the inflammatory exudate and debris, any fragment of bone which have become detached from their blood supply undergo necrosis and are attacked by macrophages and osteoclast. On stage 4, formation of granulation tissue occur. Following this phase of demolition, there is an ingrowth of capillary loops and mesenchymal cell derived from the periosteum and the endosteum of the cancellous bone. These cells have osteogenic potential and together with the newly formed blood vessel contribute to the granulation tissue formation. On stage 5 come wound bone and cartilage formation. The mesenchymal osteoblast next differentiate to form either wound bone or cartilage. The term callus, derived from the Latin and meaning hard, is often used to describe the material uniting the fracture, and regardless of its consistency, when this is granulation tissue, the callus is soft, but as bone or cartilage formation occur, it become hard. On stage 6 come formation of lamellar bone. The decalcified cartilage or worn bone is next invaded by capillaries headed by osteoclasts. As the initial scaffolding provisional callus is removed, osteoblasts lay down osteoid which calcifies to form bone. Its collagen bundles are now arranged in orderly lamellar fashion. For the most part, concentrically around the blood vessel, and in this way, the Haversian system are formed. Adjacent to the periosteum and endosteum, the lamellae are peripheral to the surface, and as in the normal bone, this phase of formation of definitive lamellar bone merged with the last stage. On stage 7 come is remodeling. The final remodeling process involving the continued osteoclastic removal and osteoblastic laying down of bone resulted in the formation of the bone, which differ remarkably little from the original tissue. The external callus is slowly removed. The intermediate callus become converted into compact bone containing Haversian system, while the internal callus is hollowed out into a marrow cavity in which only a few spicules of cancellous bone remain. So, goodbye, my dear ladies and gentlemen. If you like my lecture, so please subscribe and press the bell icon and share with others.